technical difficulty. I don't know if you all know that Dr. Ali and Princess Kadira's land was flooded on the storm that just passed. And they had a tremendous amount of damage and a lot of, you know, a whole bunch of things, but they didn't cancel. They're here, you know what I'm saying, anyway. And just doing what they can do with what they, you know. So we're all going through different things. But we all have to make this the priority to say, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? Okay, this is what they're doing. I understand all the politics, all the different things that are going on. I understand the economic situation. I understand that there are a lot of global things going on that a lot of us are not even aware of because we're so caught up with the other things that they're putting our face to look at, you know. But that's the conversation that we have to begin to have. What do we do about this? How are we involved? How does this affect us? Not them, but us. Because we are us, you know. And we've been in this position where someone else is reporting, here's what's healthy for you. Here's what you need to eat. Here's what you need to do. Here's what you need to think about. Here's the important concepts. Here's the important teachers. Here, memorize their thinking. Here's how you need to live. You know, and so all of these things, most of it is not for us. The medical community, a lot of the information is not based on us or not for our benefit. And there's a lot of others. That's a whole other conversation. That's a whole other event. You know what I'm saying? The foods and things that we eat, the commercials. I mean, there's just, the list goes on and on. We could talk about this for 2 days straight and never stop. You know, it's not for you. It's for you to buy and to be a good consumer so somebody's pockets can get padded. But at the end of the day, we're still not having a conversation about what is in our best interest. So knowing who you are, I know the goddess talked a lot about, and I hope you talk to them about the blood type. Because that's something nobody told me, hey, you need to know your blood type and eat for your blood type. And, you know, do certain things based on your blood type, based on the kind of person you are. You know, we all come from different roots. And our family lines, they come from different places. And they eat different things. And they think in certain kinds of ways. You know, so even knowing when you're born, understanding about that, understanding who you are as an individual and when and why you came to this place. So all of these things, it seems like it's not, you know, too much of anything to focus on, but it's really the most important thing for us to focus on because we came here with a purpose and, you know, instructions, basically, you know, and a lot of the concepts that we're dealing with and that we're familiar with, like, we understand the concept of being the body of God. But what does that really mean? And how, when you're a body, bodies have different systems, they have different aspects, limbs, different things, and each one has a function, and they do different things. So if that's the case, then maybe we need to come together as a body and decide who's going to do what amongst ourselves so that we can begin to function as a body of God, as opposed to, okay, we recognize this, but again, there's all of these disconnects. There's all these disconnects. So hopefully this will be a step in the direction of bridging some of those gaps and, you know, pulling it together where we need to connect. I definitely want to hear from the people who attend. Mm-hmm. And I hope that you all were able to sign in. We had a guest list back here. Whoever didn't get a chance to sign it, definitely sign it. I see our...
They did.
Okay.
Everybody signed it.
Okay. We were supposed to have a tip jar back there, but I don't see it. But when you get a chance, because this is really less about that and more about this. You know, we gotta, and that's fine. Like, we do need to make money. That's important. It's important to make money because we all have to eat. We all have to, you know, we need to build some things. We need to build. So, and it takes money to do that. But at the same time, when we put the money up front and the substance or the purpose, you know, and the essence of what we're doing in the back, and we don't make moves based on the money, or we only make moves based on the money, a lot of this stuff falls through the cracks. Because people say, hey, that's not my job. I don't get paid to do that. People say that every day. But then they're walking right by something that needs to be done. Hey, I'm not going to pick up this trash. I'm not a trash man. I don't get paid to do that. Well, this trash is littering and cluttering up and destroying the community, though. So we have to think about that. Like, whose job is it to do what is needed, not what they're getting paid for? You see what I'm saying? So the job concept, that's something else that we have to reevaluate. I think there are a lot of things that we have to reevaluate in terms of coming to know who we are and, you know, doing something with that information. Not just knowing something. Knowing is great, but you have to apply what you know. And that's another part of it. And why it's so hard to do that when we're so attuned to something else. I know, who saw The Matrix in here? Y'all saw The Matrix? Everybody, just about everybody saw The Matrix. So you remember the scene where he's like, why are my eyes hurting? And they're like, because you never used them before. Because everything he's been viewing is in this illusion. And so for some people, you might, your eyes might burn a little bit during, you know, once things get started. Because if you're not, if you're so attuned to the news and to popular culture and all of these other things, you're not used to looking outside of the illusion to the reality of what is actually going on. So, you know, I just made that reference because, you know, sometimes you get that. So if anybody, you know, if you just wanted to meet a little sign language or something where your eyes are burning or something, we'll try to bring it down a little bit. So you want to speak a little bit to the crowd about your journey?
I just want to say thank you so much for having us. I'm glad that, you know, we started manifesting this area.
Right.
Aleem, are you ready?
Whenever.
Yeah.
Well,
so I was just going to introduce you.
Okay.
Well, I was hoping, guys, you could tell a little bit about your...
Thank you,
and thank you all again for coming. I wanted you to talk a little bit and tell a little bit about the story of coming into knowing yourself. That's really what I wanted us to do.
Okay.
Because I feel like this is a journey, and it's challenging. And I feel like the more of the challenges and the story itself that we're able to share, the more people will feel comforted and encouraged to continue journeying. Because I feel like that's a part of why what we find ourselves dealing with. You know, okay, I get some information about who I am and what I'm here to do. How do I go about doing that? You know, or I find some information about, okay, let's say using food for an example. Okay, well, I find out there's so many genetically modified foods and things at the stores. And, you know, I find out that, okay, I don't need to be using this toothpaste. But what do I do now? Where do I go? Where do I? So that's kind of the journey. Find your way. Law is another thing. You know, we are law. So understanding law, natural law, spiritual law, and then how that extends to the laws, that man-made laws that we need to understand, because I know last time y'all checked, tax is getting ate up out here, and we really need to understand how this is happening, why it's happening, and what we can do about it, and everybody become actively involved in educating themselves about it. So that's another part of it. I know Dr. Aleem has plenty of information that he wants to relate, but I feel like the story is a part of this. Because how do you step out of the matrix? How do you unplug? No one's going to show up at your door like the movie and say, hey, come with me. I'm going to take you and I'm going to unplug you, literally unplug you. You as a person have to say, I'm turning this TV off. I'm going to disassociate myself with these people, or I'm just going to take a break for a minute and figure out who I am and what I need to do for myself to continue my own path of growth, of development, to get myself in alignment with what God has for me in my life and how I'm supposed to move. And so it's a different path for everybody. That's one of the statements that our teacher emphasizes, that there's many paths up the mountain. And that's just saying, there's many schools of thought. It's, you know, we all have different backgrounds, different religious upbringings, all kinds of things. And so it's a lot of different ways that you arrive at knowledge of yourself, but it's all a part of the journey. So I feel like sharing that journey, sharing those resources, sharing, you know, even suggestions of what we did when we were at a certain point in the journey, I feel like is important. But we'll have some time after to mingle and stuff, too, so we can do it that way. How are we going to do it?
Okay.
Dr. Aleem, I see you still getting prepared. And we're still waiting, too. We have a couple of other presenters, like I said, that had some car trouble. So we probably throw them in at the end, maybe after the break.
I'm always in the background, so. But I am going to say something. I'm loving the fact that the women are taking this torch and adding on.
Right.
Because honestly, I feel like that's why consciousness was in the back seat, because we were in the back seat.
Right.
You know, we'll pass it down to the children. So just some ideas. I love giving ideas. There are some great videos online. Sister was talking about toothpaste and stuff like that. You can make your own. You know, with baking soda, because y'all remember our grandmothers used baking soda. Well, baking soda, come to find out, it helps to destroy cancerous cells in your body. And every morning they were brushing their teeth with baking soda. And my grandmother's 94. And my other grandmother, she crossed over 5 years ago. She was 94. You know, so different little things they were doing that was helping them maintain through this stressful society. Mm-hmm. I also want to know say another thing that helps us maintain through this stressful society, family. You know, a lot of times we send our children, just like you were saying earlier, a lot of times we send our children off to school and they're not being taught that family at their home is the most important. They're just trying to get an A. So it is difficult to serve two masters. You're trying to get yelled at by your parents or what have you, to wash dishes or to clean up, da, da, da. But your teacher, she's going to give you your grade. So it's like trying to respect what you have at home, which is not being taught at school. Mm-hmm. So just family. And a lot of times when we get on this information, our family, you know, blackballs us. This is something that they don't want to deal with. This is something they put in the back seat. So I'm just grateful that we're here. I'm grateful that we're waking up, because that's what's going to help our society. I always say that we're a third world country. Melanated people are a third world country. You know, we are in the United States of America, but we are still a third world country because we don't have everything that we need. Well, we do, but we don't utilize it. We have it in each other. So the emphasis of family is bold and underlined. If you can connect with one person, with your children, connect with somebody so y'all can build and start writing down goals that you want to see manifest. The bees are dying. So guess what? We need people who will harvest honey and bees, you know? And it's like $150 to get what you need, the smoke spray and then, you know, the little container that the bees will go in. So I would say let's utilize our 9-to-5 jobs in order to stimulate something that we can have on our own. Mm-hmm. When you look at a ketchup bottle, it says established since 1865. That is somebody who respect their great-great-great-grandfather's idea, and it is now still here. You know, so I would love to see us manifest that, you know? Some other ideas, making your own detergent. That helps to save money. A lot of times we are spending like $15 to maybe $30 on laundry detergent. You can spend that one time and have enough for the year. You know, so then that money that is saved can be utilized in order to build things. There was another little girl. She was 11. Honeybee Lemonade. She sold it to 360 Whole Foods. That little girl is making $11 million for her family. I want us to take our children and instead of seeing them as hindrances or somebody who look like their daddy or, you know what I mean? That you got these videos on Facebook where these children are cursing and they cursing better than adults and, you know, and the parents are beating them and they want to tape and show the whole world how they done beat the heck out their child. You know, I want us to see our children as on the team, you know right. What I mean? Because our children love us so much, they will, after getting whooped, they will come in there an hour later and hug you. That is humility, which most adults don't even have. So that is somebody who was on the team, thick or thin, good or bad, you know what I mean? We already have what we need. They're actually the best parts of us. So teach them babies how to make jewelry. Teach them babies something, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. Ask them what their dreams were,
right.
You know, because we, and that's another thing too, the average person gets 4 ideas that will make them rich a year. But we just are so busy, we'll just let it go or we won't write it down. You know what I mean? So we need to make sure we write down our dreams and asking our children what their dreams were and listening to each other, like you were saying, to each other, because a lot of times the spirit is moving through us. That's wisdom. You know, so listening to our children, family is the most important. If you look at other cultures, I love this. The Jewish lady told me that grandfather, he'll come in at 7 years old and he says, look, you know, it's about time. So they'll all split $1 million policy because they know grandpa gonna die. But we, for some reason, think that something is wrong with that, you know, so I just want us to come together. We need to be having family day or family meeting where we come together and do stuff, play a game or just get to know each other and deal with each other as far as with love. Constantly dealing with each other as far as love, because family is just so important. If your mother cannot handle you talking about no withdrawal leave, well, then you talk about Jesus with her. I don't care what you have to do, but have a relationship with our family. You know, they're the ones that you receive your inheritance from. Mm-hmm. So I know I'm all over the place dealing with economics, but I really want us to start tapping into that. Mm-hmm. I feel like the oldest people on the planet, you know, are at the lesser aspects of things, and that's because the root of family, you know? Mm-hmm. I've seen so many mothers and daughters not getting along. I've seen so many husband and wives not getting along. And it's because of humility, ego, and lack of knowledge, and also lack of love. So, Aileen, I know you can always jump in, but people came to see you. I'm glad I got to say something, but people came to see you. So without,
that's important.
Yeah, and then also to the children, because you could. This is Brother Messiah. He's about to go to college. He's going on his first date today. So y'all definitely send him some love for that. I'm just so proud of him. Y'all remember those days, you know? Another science with our children. We have to remember that there's nothing new under the sun. And I'm just not dissing the sisters because I love y'all. I need y'all. But if we teach our boys to take a while before they're intimate, then they won't get a baby mama who's tripping, feeding that baby crazy food and giving that baby vaccinations. But we remember, we went through that already. But if we're not communicating that to them, then how will they know? How will they know? We are each other's solutions, you know? So tantra, when our children need to know about the science of sex, it's not just, you know, something that's wonderful feeling, but it is also a healing. It is also... it's also a way to grow. You know what I mean? We need to be blending our families where the children are going to be the
Speaking
most elite, the most healthy, you know? And they're going to be singing and dancing. They deal with music, art, and culture. So it's beautiful how the family just comes together and everybody sings from the infants to the older children. You know, so they're a really good example to mimic and to be inspired by. Peace, Melchiz.
Yeah, peace, mister.
Peace, Marley. I can't wait till y'all perform. I just was telling everybody about y'all. Yeah, but, you know, it's just so much. It's so much, you know. Also, too, there was a video I just recently watched, and it was they had taken some celery. And y'all know we stir fry different things like that. But they took the bottom of the celery and just put it in some water. And it continued to grow celery. And you can cut that again another 20 days and you got some more celery. You can do that with lettuce. You know, these different things will help save at least $30 a month on groceries. You know, so. Yeah. Yeah. I am so glad you said that because so does a banana. A banana a day will bring down your blood pressure. And that's deep because Aileen's blood pressure was 218 over 111. Okay? And now his blood pressure is 124 over 86. Okay? A banana. We're sitting up here with the cure, not that other stuff they got. Yes, got it.
Well, apple cider vinegar with the mother in it.
Okay.
Okay.
That's how you know you got all the answers right with you.
Yeah.
Tell them about our parents, even our good parents, and share those things with us. You know?
Tell them it's potential.
Taught us everything we know. But we've forgotten our parents, our forefathers.
I am so glad y'all are interacting. That's what these conferences should be. It should be networking because we have everything we need most oftentimes in the room that we're in, just like the goddess was just saying. So, gotta speak louder. It's so true. That apple cider vinegar, it is so true.
Yeah, you can get anywhere now. Mm-hmm. And it lasts forever. I get a big one and I just take a teaspoon every day. Mm-hmm.
It is so true.
It's good for your skin. If you have dermatitis, and you mix that with like a little baking soda, like you were saying, put it there. Well, you know, we have dry scalp or eczema or whatever.
Raises
the
pH level.
Yeah, it raises the pH level. It does the same thing to your gut flora. Mm-hmm. Take it every day. Dr. Lane, take it every day. Blood pressure. My father has hypertension.
Okay. I don't have it.
Well, not anymore. Thank you so much, Goddess. You know, powerful. You know, apple cider vinegar also will help, like with the young girls when they're starting to be intimate, and it helps with yeast infections. You know, so it's just so many cures out here that we don't need to get the synthetic stuff that has all these lists of side effects. And a lot of times we see our grandparents taking this stuff and we see them deteriorating. But
your liver
testing,
comes out of the pores of their skin.
It really is. We have everything we need. We really do.
You testing, huh?
Oh, that's good. I'm loving that. Look at that. 8-9.
Look at that.
Slowly but surely. Wow. Wow. Are you ready, God?
Okay.
Go to the herbs.
Oh, but you know what, too, God? It's a lot of herbs that will help with hypertension. Neem, black walnut, cayenne pepper. Cayenne pepper actually stopped Aleem's carcinoma. The blood vessel busting in his head, the cayenne pepper stopped that.
Mm-hmm.
It really does.
My
great
people that used to fast and they did the vinegar all day and they had no food. They do the cayenne pepper and mix it with lemon and then
yeah.
Their metabolism so you don't get draggy.
Yeah. That is so on point. It helps with losing weight.
It
also
master cleanse.
Yeah, the master cleanse.
That's right.
Ulcers.
Yeah.
Inflammation.
Yeah.
Can
we put the microphone in the middle so
they can? Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Because we have what we need right here in each other. You know, we can't emphasize that enough, that we need to come together and build, you know. And if you don't get along with your immediate family, it will manifest if you continue to manifest it in your mind. But get along with whoever you connect with chemistry, and you build with them, you know. Because we all know each other, because you'll begin to learn each other's strengths and weaknesses. And whoever you can't build with, then that's just the chemistry. You can't build with them. Just try to build with someone else, you know. But we need to be on every vibration building. That's why I'm glad that Trump is in. Because, and I know that's kind of like a sore spot for people because I don't want to offend anybody. However, it's going to force us to build. It's definitely going to force us to build. You know, when you're comfortable, you don't build. But when you got your behind to the wall, you're going to get in there and do something. You know? What was you going to say, God?
I just was thinking, you know, we take a lot of our energies and give it to the European. Think back in the days when they used to feed off our grandparents' breasts, take that woman's breasts.
Mm-hmm.
And they may not be doing that now openly, you see, but they're feeding off our energies while we're at that job working for them.
Mm.
At every course, whether positive or negative, they're still feeding off our energy. Using that energy to destroy us and build themselves up.
Okay, you just dropped a jewel, brother. Didn't he? Because that's so true. It is so true, but that's okay because we are inspiring people to use that 9-to-5 money. Because you're right, you can't tell them you're going to school. If you tell them you're going to school, what happens? They fire you or you get less time. Or y'all know what I'm talking about.
You signed a contract. You can work for us for a year if you're going to school for that.
Okay.
Not give you a promotion.
You know what I'm talking about, you know? So be inspired to use our 9-to-5s to create our own businesses. You know, it's as simple as, like, money, right? We have money goes through our hands all the time. Well, ignorance is no excuse. So when you have, like, a bicentennial quarter, did you know that quarter was worth $3 or $6? Did you know that? You know, so it's different ways that we can formulate money through education. Making jewelry, selling produce, making clothes, you know, these are things that we're gonna wear. It's clothes. So I know this one dude, he was out of jail, he deals with Islam, and he was like, what can I do that I won't have to worry about working for anybody? He said, I could do flooring. Everybody walks on the floor. So tap into that vibration so that we can have more. I want us to grow, you know, and I know that we can. We're so capable of it. You know? Anybody else want to say something before Aleem goes in? Peace to the newcomers. So glad y'all came. Yeah. Looking all beautiful. Yeah. I know I told you east and it was south.
Okay.
I've never been here, God.
I'm everybody.
But thank you so much for coming. Mm-hmm. But I hope y'all brought y'all poems and y'all rhymes and your thoughts because we will be having a time for that because we want to hear from everybody. You know, I think that's so important. Okay, but without any further ado, is Aleem going on first?
Somebody was going. Okay.
Hold on.
Okay, some other great ideas is doing natural hair. A lot of us have natural hair, so guess what? We would know how to do that. Okay. And then also natural products. I had my hands was ashy, my face was ashy. I forgot to bring my own lotion, you know? So I stopped at the Dollar Tree and I bought this stuff and I was like, well, it was Family Dollar. And they said, don't put it on your face, don't put it on your... I'm like, no, that's what I need it for. So I got to take it back, but I'm just saying we need some natural stuff, you know? And it's not difficult to make, you know? And these are other ideas that the children can be doing because people will buy from children. They know that that's an investment in the future. Little Mister come up there talking about, or Baby Marley come up there, or Mail Chairs. You know, you can't not give Mail Chairs $5. He come up there talking about, he goes some body oil. It's sandalwood. you know you're not gonna be able to get no sandalwood body oil, you know, cream from Walmart. So we'll definitely support the seeds, you know. We just do. So I definitely want to emphasize, you know, giving them ideas in order to be economically savvy and sound. You ready, guys? I'm ready. I'm just talking.
Thank you, Goddess.
Thank y'all too for listening and adding on. I need y'all. I appreciate y'all.
You gotta share that brilliance. Share it.
Peace. We're gonna get it going.
Peace. All right, for those who might not know me, I'm Dr. Aleem Albay. We're going to be dealing with quite a bit of information today. Hold on. Can y'all hear me? Okay, there we go. Am I loud enough? Can everybody hear me? Okay. All right, so we're going to be dealing with quite a bit of info today. This lecture is called The Manifestation of God. All right, so we're going to be dealing with everything you can possibly think of. From the spiritual to the mundane, all right? Hence, from the higher self to the lower self. We're going to get into everything that we possibly can. All right, so, I think that's good. That's good, right? All right, so, before I go anywhere, I normally start out with any questions. Yes, I knew we did.
Yeah, I'm taping it now, guys. And you was on the record.
Yep. I don't know about the day.
We'll make sure you get a copy.
Yeah, we'll make sure everybody make you get a copy. At least know where to get it from. Yes. All right. So,
any other questions?
Any other questions before we get started? All right. All right. So when we talk about spiritual, we talk about the breath. If you go to Webster Dictionary and look up the word spirit, embedded inside the definition, you will see the word breath. If you go to the definition of breath, inside the definition, you will see the word spirit. They are both simultaneous. They are both synonymous, I should say. So they really, when people say that that they are spiritual, that means that they must be a breatharian. But oftentimes, that's not the concept that we get. Oftentimes, when a person says that they're spiritual, we're thinking, oh, you must deal with some type of religious aspect. Religion has nothing to do with the breath. Unless you take it back to the original conception of the word religion, which is from the Latin, which means to religo, which means to bind back. What are you attempting to tie or bind back to? It is to God. All right, it is to your higher self. All right, in Christianity, it's referred to as what? Your Lord and personal Savior. We think that that's a spooky concept. Really, it's not. It's your soul embedded inside of your pineal gland. That is where your divine deity is, the one God, in which that controls this one body. But we think that it's just a God external of ourselves, somewhere outside, and you have to go and search for that one deity, or that one God, or that one Allah, or whomever in which the name or various cultures in which that we refer to it as. That's our concept. But our concept is very limited because it's not just external, which deals with exoteric. It's internal, which deals with esoteric. It's an internal process that we have to go through. When we go to the book of Revelation and it speaks about the seven seals of the seven churches, we are thinking that it's actually seven churches outside of us somewhere. That is not the concept. The concept is that there's seven Elohims, or the seven eyes of God, or the seven eyes of Allah, which actually are your seven chakras, which are your internal mechanism, which is based on your endocrine gland system. You have seven major endocrine glands. Your pineal gland, your pituitary gland, your thyroid, parathyroid glands, your thymus gland, your spleen and pancreas, and your adrenal glands. For the woman, the uterus and ovaries. For the male, the prostate and the testes. These are the seven major endocrine glands in the body, in the human anatomy. Now, why is that important? Because it correlates to the seven churches, or the seven chakras, or the seven seals. The Bible says the seven seals have to be open. Well, if you understand the body, the seven endocrine glands are based on the seven ductless, or what's called the seven ductless hormonal glands. That means each of these glands produce hormones. All right? Your pineal gland is the master gland of the physical anatomy. All right? Everything in which that comes down, which is what we refer to as esoteric or eternal or external, comes down into that concentration in which that's where the soul is embedded at, and it acts as a step-down transformer of electromagnetic energy, or what is known as prana or chi or ki energy, depending on the culture. If it's in Hawaii, it's called kahuna mana. If it's here within the States and you're a Christian, it's called Holy Spirit. If you are in the Orient, in China, it's chi. If you're in Japan, it's ki. If you're in India, it's prana. So these are all various names of the same substance, which is the universal life force energy, in which that not only can sustain you, but you are a concentration of. All right? Now, understand the concentration. Seven generations on your mother's side, seven generations on your father's side. You are a perfect concentration of their thought energy in human form. So you are a walking thought form. Scientists have even stated in quantum physics that not only are you a walking thought form, but your physical body, more than 90% of it, is composed of stardust material. Stardust particles. Material. Now, hold on. What is stardust? You got to think about what stardust is. Yes. You are made of stars. This is why when you go and watch the movie Lion King, and Mufasa, who is the father of Simba, is sad about his father, but what happens after his father dies? What do Mufasa becomes?
A star.
Go ahead.
A bad star?
He becomes a star. He becomes a star up in the sky. Now, why is that interesting? It's because all the indigenous cultures around the world state the same thing. Is that you become a star up in the sky after you pass physical form. Is that something in which that is so alienated from us to understand? Or is it something in which that all of the indigenous cultures overstand? For example, if you go to Australia, if you go to here within the Native American culture, if you go to Africa and meet with the shamans, you will find that they all state the same thing, is that we are, quote unquote, star beings. So when people talk about extraterrestrials, we're all extraterrestrial in that sense, because we're all extra terra, which is Earth, astral beings, which means we are all extra astral beings on Earth, terra, extraterrestrial. We are all beings here on this planet, and we all came from that stardust material. This is the thing that we have to realize, that in order for you to exist, a star had to die. This is where you get the story concept of 2,000 years ago about Jesus dying for your sins. A star had to die so that you could have your skin. In other words, so you can be a material thing. a third-dimensional being. But a star had to implode or explode, depending on the amounts of the various states of energy coming forth from that star, but you become that concentration. That is what is brought down when the mother and father is in the intimacy act, and a vortex opens up, and that soul, which is that stardust energy, comes down in order to manifest into physical being and actually to interact with all those elements, which we refer to as hydrogen, helium, so forth and so on, all the way down to the 118 on the periodical chart. All right? On the periodical chart, the first element is what? Hydrogen. Well, what is the majority of energy that comes off from the sun or from any star?
Hydrogen.
Well, isn't it interesting that you are basically composed of 99 elements of those 118 elements? And is it a coincidence that Muslims say that they chant the 99 names or attributes of Allah? That's interesting. And I'm showing you how all these religions correlate to your very existence. They're not something that's so wacky out that you can't get the truth from it. But the thing is that everybody think that they just have it by themselves. And they're as if they exist in a vacuum. And it's not true. None of them are the first to come with these concepts. There's been many prophets, apostles, preachers, teachers, doctrines, and which that have come way before any of this information. Let me explain a little bit further. If you go to a book, it's called Forbidden Archaeology, and it's written by Michael Creedmore and Richard L. Thompson. They have another one called The Hidden History of the Human Race. In that book, they go and show you and tell you about relics that have been discovered in South Africa that dates back to 2.8 billion years ago. 2.8 billion years ago. This is way further than what you refer to as Dag Nashor Lucy, which they found 2.8 to 3.2 million years ago. You're talking about 2.8 billion years ago, they found a relics in South Africa. They, matter of fact, they found over 200 of them embedded in rocks that date back to 2.8 billion years ago. That means somebody was smelting metal 2.8 billion years ago. Who's the oldest people on the planet?
We are.
Exactly. You are. You come from the oldest bloodline on the planet. All
right? That's how you know we're going to get it right.
Yeah, right. So, you are direct descendants of the oldest people on the planet whose history dates back to at least 2.8 billion years ago. All right? So now, think about all that genetic material and information that you have actually latent within your DNA. Think about that. I'll get to that in a minute. All right. So, we know that if you go to King James, the Bible, the 40, Isaiah 45, the third verse, it says, "And I will give thee the treasures of darkness and the hidden riches of secret places, that thou may know that I, the Lord, which call thee by thy name, am the God of Israel." Now, understand the treasures of darkness. What is that? The treasures of darkness is talking about dark energy and what is referred to as dark matter. That is more than 96% of our universe that is unseen. Only 4% of our universe is seen by scientists. That is everything else. That is the moons, the stars, the planets, asteroids, comets, etc. Only 4% is visible. All right? That's something deep. So right here in the verse 7, it says, "I form the light and create darkness." All right? And it says, I make peace and create evil. I, the Lord, do all these things. Now, that's interesting because what we refer to as, let me go back, and refer to as Israel, the word Israel within Hebrew means to ascend to God. All right, to ascend to God. Ascend means to go up. Well, that's interesting because if you read the story about Prophet Muhammad on the night of Miraj, what happens? He gets on a donkey-like animal, and he is taken up. He ascends through the seven heavens, and he meets with God on the night of power. And this is when he get or receive his instructions about how many times we're supposed to pray. It starts out with 100 times. He's like, 50, 20, 10, you're getting closer. It went down to 5. All right? Now, the Bible, the Old Testament tells you actually that the Israelites did it 3 times a day, morning, afternoon, and evening. That was their prayer times. And it still is to this very day. All right? For those who are Hebrews or Israelites. All right? More should be doing the same thing. All right? So we know that 3 were specified. Even in the Quran, it specified at least 3 times. But based on hadiths, it was given us at least 5. All right? I won't get into all of that. That's something that they have to get an understanding, understanding of. So, we talk about dark matter and dark energy. This is what we come to the conclusion of. Could this mysterious form of energy, in particular dark energy, be the accumulation of remnants of life energy which departed from all living organisms throughout the universe when they died? That's a question. That's in its highest manifestation, that is, for those in which that no longer had to incarnate again. Because there is a process of incarnation. The Bible tells us that. All the ancient scriptures tell us that. If you get the Upanishads, the Bhagavad Gita, if you get the Buddha, the 5 baskets of Buddha Zen, if you get the Zoroastrian texts, if you get the Bible, in the book of John, the disciples asked Jesus, well, whom shall we say that is,
who you are?
Who you are. And some say that you're the prophet of old. Some say that you are Elijah. Now, remember now, if we're talking about 2,000 years ago, Elijah was 1,000 years before Jesus. But they said Elijah. Some say that you're Jeremiah. Now, this is what the disciples were asking Jesus was saying about to Jesus. That's deep. So he was saying, and he didn't correct him. He didn't say anything. He just simply said, well, Peter, who do you say that I am? And Peter said, oh, you're the living Christ. All right, we'll roll with that. There we go. He liked his answer better. But if Jesus was against the signs of reincarnation, he would have chastised them right then on the spot, wouldn't he? But they were saying Jeremiah, one of the prophets of old. They were saying Elias. They were saying all these individuals. And then Jesus was also asked by the disciples, that, hold on, we read that in the days that were before us, in the last day, that Elijah would come. And Jesus said, surely he has. That was John the Baptist. That was in the same book. And that's deep. So in both accounts, reincarnation is spoken of in the Bible, but yet the vast majority of Christians states that there is no evidence of it. Yet it's right there in the same book I read from a child. I read the Bible 4 times by the time I was 14 years old, from 11 to 14. All the way through. So I didn't go by the Bible. I went through the Bible. All right? But that is how that was my beginnings. But I just didn't stop there because I was like, there's more. There's more information that we have to know because there's something going on here that is not being explained properly. All right? So There's three states, as we was talking about. We said dark matter, dark energy, but there's another state called aether. All right? Aether is the third state. Now, this is known within the Quran as triple stage darkness. Now, that's interesting, again, because the woman has three trimester periods. The first 3 months, the second 3 months, and the third 3 months. 3 times 3 is the number 9. All right? So, the child is inside of what is called triple stage darkness, or the veil. All right? That is known as the veil. There's three veils. You have the amniotic sac. You have the uterine wall. And you have another wall, which I can't think of right now. But there's three walls in which that protect the child. All right, that protect the child inside of the mother's womb, which is known as triple stage darkness. So the three states in which that we refer to as triple state of darkness, which is, once again, dark matter, dark energy, and also aether. These three correlates to the same within the mother. So the woman symbolizes the epitome of creation in human form. She is a replica of the universe in physical form. Man is too. However, the woman, more so because she actually is who mold and shape and form life in the womb in that triple stage darkness to bring forth male and female. All right, even though the male is known to spark that life, you know, but the life principle is formed, shaped, and molded. That would be the 13th attribute of Allah, which is called Al-Musawwiru, which is talking about the form, or what is known also as the fashioner. All right, so we know that the first state of thermodynamics is also known as the law of conservation of energy. And it states that energy can neither be what? Created nor destroyed. Energy can only be transferred or changed from one form to another. All right? That is what it stated, right? Mm-hmm. Now, that's why we gave that premise. Could the dark energy be the accumulation of all those lives that have reached, you know, their life lessons? All right? Now, we continue on. All right, for example, what we found out is that what is emitted from the body at the point of death are electrons. All right? The last breath is an exhale. When you are coming into this world, is an inhale, insulation. Right? The doctor spanked the child on the behind after they pull the fluid and stuff out of the nose, and the child takes his first insulation. At that insulation of that first breath going in is the activation of the soul. That's when the soul becomes activated, is at that point. Now, there's areas in the body in which that the soul can get activated through. That's the crown, what is known as the fontanelle, which is right here, that little soft spot on the top of the child's head from the age of, you know, from the age of birth all the way up to the age of 7. Then when it starts getting hard-headed, the child develops a personality. Then, you know, just like grandma used to tell me, go sit your little hard-headed behind down somewhere. Because now my head did get hard. And that happens around the age of 7, when I develop my own little personality. All right, within Islam, you know what I'm saying, the mother turns over the responsibility, some of the responsibility of the male child to the father at the age of 7. That's no coincidence. That because they say that the child is protected, all right, from Shaitan to the age of 7. Until he get, and then he be at the age of 7, he begins his instruction within the Holy Quran. All right? That is all correlation to what is going on, you know what I'm saying? They just put their own traditions behind it, but it's still something that is valid for each and every one of who came through Christianity. You know, because we also say the same thing. All right? This from age of 0 or birth, coming to the age of 7, that first 7 years correlates to the child learning about physical existence. That's why if you notice, to the child about 8, 7, they are so clumsy. They'll breaking things up. They throwing things up. They tearing, ripping things up. They taking things apart because they're trying to figure out what they can, you know, their limitations or what, you know, or, you know, what can they do? Then from age of 7 or 8 going into age of 14, they start dealing with the etheric body. This is when they start having these phenomenal dreams and they go into dreaming and, you know, into color. Of course, this can start at a younger age. But I know some adults who still dream in black and white. Matter of fact, me and this brother Johnny, his name is Jahar now, we was in a barber shop getting ready to get a haircut. And brother was sitting in the chair. And the brother told, and he was talking about dreams. You know, we were just in there listening, talking about dreams. And the brother said, this is a brother now. This brother said that he's 30 years old and he dreams in black and white. And me and Johnny looked at each other. We started cracking up and laughing. We got up and walked out because we like, we don't need to be around him. Because it ain't no way possible that you 30 years old and still dreaming in black and white, bro. Unless you are dwelling in your lower self. In your higher self, at the heart chakra, you dream in color. I'm sorry. You got the color. All right? So, that is the thing. All right? So, you have to raise yourself up. That's part of those seven vibrations or those seven churches, those seven chakras, the Shinkaras or Aritus, as they refer to as. The seven souls of Ra is known within the Book of Coming Forth by Day and Night. Misnomer by E.A. Wallace Budge as the Book of the Dead. Now, what scientists have done is actually take the physical body at the point of death, and at death, they realize that there's 21 grams of weight differentiation. In other words, there's 21 grams of weight that has been lost at death. 21 grams of weight that has been lost at death. So scientists have figured out that that is part of the electronic emissions, as well as which is from the cells, and also the last breath itself, which is dealing with the vapor. All right, which is the mist, which is symbolic to the spirit. So the electrons would be symbolic to the soul. The concentration of electrons emissions would be in your pineal gland, all right, which is where your soul is embedded at. So that means that this emission that is released at the point of death, which is your spirit and soul, it is also part of what is called your Aku, all right, within the Kemetic traditions or Temerian traditions. They realize that there's three bodies that survive death. You are a seventh degree or seven multidimensional being. You have seven bodies, not just your physical body. We think that we are just our physical body because we all heard the song, "You only human, of flesh and blood, a man." Huh? But that's what we thought, right? But no. Yes. But you are etherian, so you're not just a physical being. You have an ethereal body. You have an astral or emotional body. You have a mental body. You have a caudal body, a spiritual body, and a soul body. All right? You have all these bodies right now and right here. This is why when you take a Kirlian camera or photography camera, we can actually take a picture of you and we can see your auric colors. In other words, your astral colors in your auric field. All right? You can do the same thing with a plant. Take a leaf from a plant. Take your Kirlian camera, and you can actually see the outline of electrical or electromagnetic light around the leaf. All right? So there is an electronic emission in which that leaves the physical body. What's the difference between a living person and a dead person?
Breath.
One breathe, one doesn't.
Okay.
Exactly. Because the breath is what give you what? The ability to move. It give you life. This is why when you read the book of Genesis, it says, God breathed into the nostrils of man the breath of life, and man became what? A living soul. So what did God breathe of his divine essence? It was called the breath of life. So the breath is what? The spirit, which is divinely connected to that soul principle, because you are a living soul. This is why it says that you are a what? Spiritual being having a human existence. As compared to you thinking that you are a human being having a spiritual existence. It's the other way around. We have to flip it. So, the electrons, scientists have found out in quantum physics, that they said that the electrons goes around in a 360-degree circle and then disappears from sight, from view, and then goes obviously into another 360-degree sphere somewhere else. But it goes undetected. That's deep. So they can see the first 360 degrees, but when it comes back to the other 360 degrees, it can't tell. But guess what? Once it makes that rotation back to that 360 degrees, which goes undetected, it comes back into sight again. It makes another 360 degrees. That correlates once again to what? Reincarnation. That even electrons do that. Well, guess what? Scientists have found out also that electrons, when it leaves the physical body, have a tendency of coming back and forming another human body or being part of what we refer to as another accumulation of material, elemental parts, a human body again. So the same electrons that leaves are the same electrons that comes back and form another body. So we find out that God is, in theology, is defined by several characteristics. The divine simplistic, which means not consisting of parts. So when Muslims say, La ilaha illallah, waduhu la sharika lahu. La ilaha illallah means nothing would exist if Allah didn't create it. He's alone and has no partners. Okay. Omnipresent means present everywhere and is eternal. Omniscient, which means all-knowing. Omnipotent, which means all-powerful. Omnibenevolence, which means all good. Creator, sustainer, and destroyer of all. All right? G-O-D. Generator, operator, destroyer. Giver of life and bringer of death. This is what we refer to as the characteristics of God. So based on the definition of God, the electron is the only empirical object which satisfies all the criteria. All right? So the electron is divinely simplistic because the doctrine of divine simplicity states that God is without parts, not composed, composite, and not made up of every something else. The electron is a subatomic fundamental particle having no components of substructure. All right? The electron is omnipresent because all matter is composed of atoms, and all atoms are composed of at least one or more electrons. Thus, everywhere there is something, there is at least one electron. Right? Also, neurons are the cells that are the core component of the brain, which possesses and transmits information in the form of electrons or electrical signals. Electrons are what through thought, ideas, and knowledge are made of. Literally, everything that is known is facilitated by way of electrons. Electrons is omnipotent because all of the forces of the universe are based on the four fundamental forces, and electrons, particles, or participates in all three of the four fundamental forces: gravitation, electromagnetism. And the electroweak forces. All right, so electrons do not participate in the strong nuclear force, but electrons can participate in nuclear reaction. All right, electrons is omnibenevolent. All right, the seven rules of equation states that the electron always adheres to include the what is called the Pauli exclusion principle. Also, the Schrodinger equation and the Dirac equation, the wave particle duality and the angular momentum, just to name a few. All right, don't get too scientific, but we just showing the correlation. The electron is created. It says, conversely, The chemical reaction which destroys and transforms one substance to another involves the loss or change in position of electrons. That goes back to what we just finished talking about. All right? I'm going to get more into it. The electrons give life. Life is a characteristic of physical entities having biological processes, and the biological processes are of any number of chemical reactions that thus results in the transformation. So chemical reactions are caused by the loss or change in position of electrons. Conversely, the concession of chemical reactions is when electrons stop flowing, and that is what brings about death, or what appears to stop flowing. Actually, there is no, what is the difference between physics and quantum physics? In physics, they tell you that there's a state of called inertia. There is no state of inertia. Everything continues to vibrate. It just goes undetected. That's what quantum physics had to come in order to explain that. There is no state of inertia. So what appears to be a state of stoppage isn't a state of stoppage. It continues to move, all right? So what happens is that, remember, we just said that the electron goes 360 degrees detected, then 360 degrees undetected. They're talking about the undetected realm is what they're talking about. How do we know that realm exists? Because get the book Unk. All right, Unk, the electromagnetism, the science of electromagnetism. All right, get that book. It's written by Nur Unk Amin. In that book, Nur Unk Amin, he states specifically that there's a mirror-like image in which that is called heaven, that the Christian speaks about, Muslims and Jews speak about, but is over the earth and is a mirror, and it's called the ionosphere. The ionosphere, everything that's in the ionosphere is a duplication of everything that is on earth. That means everything that, no matter how faint it appears, everything that is here on earth is the exact same in the ionosphere. So when people talk about they want to go to heaven, they don't know where heaven is. Well, the book, the Unk book, explains where heaven is. It is in the ionosphere. The ionosphere is heaven. All right? The ionosphere is heaven. All right? Peace. All right. So the ionosphere is heaven. That's where heaven is. All right? And it's one of the seven heavens or atmospheres. Y'all know that? You have the stratosphere, the mesosphere, the magnetosphere. You have the ionosphere. And you have seven of these particular spheres. But the ionosphere is the mirror sphere. And it looks, and everything that's here on Earth is identical there. So think about it. If you leave your physical body here, where you go to? You go there. All right, I just decoded some of this stuff I'm just going to let that. Right. I'm just going to let that, marinate for a little bit.
That's when you get this saying, as above, so below.
As above, so below. As within, so without. Because think about it. Why would you have to waste 60, 70, 80, 90, 100 some odd years of your life just speaking where heaven is and not really knowing where you're going? Think about it. My great-grandmother lived to be 101 years old. She has still been waiting for a white man to come out the clouds in order to save her? I'm just asking. Anybody in here? Think about that, y'all. Because it was speculated. Now, she just passed in 2004, 2005. She just passed around that time. That was four, going on to 5 years after Jesus supposed to came back in 2000. You remember Prince's song? He's going to party like it's 1999 because 2000 is getting ready to be, Jesus is getting ready to go. Y'all remember that? The Y2K is supposed to hit, Jesus is supposed to came on the scene, fix the computers for him. Why Jesus supposed to did that for them? Now, I ain't got no problem with Yahshua, but I got a problem with white Jesus. Because, I'm sorry. Anyway. All right, so this is what we found out. our galaxy has 300 billion stars. 1 in 5 stars have an Earth-like planet with liquid water. Thus, roughly 60 billion Earths-like planets in our galaxy alone. But our galaxy is small. The Milky Way galaxy is small, right? Some have up to 1 trillion stars. How many galaxies are there? In our observable universe, there are about 170 billion galaxies, and each one up to 1 trillion stars. This means that there are approximately 24 squared 20 Earth-like planets in our universe. I'm just giving you just that scenario. So remember, we were talking about dark matter, dark energy, and what happens to the life in which that resonates to that frequency? And is there a reincarnation? And where you go to after death? All of these things are explained based on combining the science of religion, or I should say combining religion with science. If you have them separated, one seems as a fairy tale, the other one seems as if it's far-fetched. Did you come from apes? Hell no. You didn't come from apes. That's the problem that they got wrong. That's what they got wrong. Everything else, it makes sense. If you correlate it to religion. If you correlate it without it, no. What they're talking about, apes, ape cannot spring forth and create. Understand is that we're not talking about evolution. De-evolution maybe, but not evolution. An ape can't become a man because that is evolution over time, all right? Now, can man evolve into a beast-like creature? Yes, okay? This is the links that they're talking about and which that they keep bringing up. So get the book Human Devolution by Michael Creedmoor and Richard L. Thompson. Michael Creedmoor specifically wrote this book. It's called Human De-evolution. And what they found out is that this, is that also, let me tell you another good book, Secret Doctrine by Madame Blavatsky, all right? She specifically states in it that man did not come from apes. Man was an etheric being, all right? Now, what is etheric? Ether, all right? What is ether? Ether is mist. You have solid, liquid, and gas. The state above gas is a more refined state than gas, and that is ether. All right? So you have solid, liquid, and gas. Let's look at the physical composition of the body. All right? You are 25% apparent solid, right? 75% water. But there's a part in there in which that they don't speak about. Because that, if it's 25% apparent solid and 75% water, then there's something going on because there had to be some other percentage in there because you're just more than water and what? Solid. And guess what? Even the solid material, guess what they say? If you get Ageless Timeless Body, Ageless Mind, written by Deepak Chopra, he states in there is that your physical composition or your atomic body is 99.999% empty space. That means even what you think is solid actually is empty space, or what appears to be empty space. 99.9999% empty space. Now, we ain't saying that there's nothing in space, because actually space has the most violent physics. All right, because that is where these principles from antimatter and matter takes place at. That is the collision in which that takes place between antimatter and matter, in which that forms life. That is in space, time and space, all right? But this is a good thing, right? So the Hindus say that if God wished to hide, God would chose man to hide in. This is the last place man will look for God. Now, that makes sense. I mean, all of y'all was jamming when Mary came out, the God in me. I know I was. I had that joint turned up. It's the God in me. Oh, that was the joint. I played that joint 2 years straight. 2 years straight. All right, so all organisms breathe, right? In order to live, we breathe. But breathing is more than the act of keeping ourselves alive. Breathing unites the mind, body, and spirit. To understand the power of the breath, in this way, we need to consider the act of breathing as understood through physiotherapeutic evidence. So let's put it that way. If you control your breath, you control your mind. If you control your mind, you control your life. If you get the book, Living on Light offers the possibility that and maintained by the universal life force energy called prana. Some sages and saints have done this before by simply breathing and living, you know, which is the primary substance. They're called breatharians. And they get nurtured from the purest source, which is universal life force, which contains all bodily needs. What is that principle? When people say that, what is it that they're talking about? What is that element? Well, it's the first element on the periodical chart. It's hydrogen. All right? What is the motive force behind oxygen? There's a force behind oxygen. It's hydrogen. Because oxygen is the eighth element on the periodical chart. All right? Hydrogen is the first element on the periodical chart. So hydrogen is the moving force behind all the other elements, plus oxygen. All right? Now, you get the book, 777 by Aleister Crowley. He tells you in that book that Jesus Christ's name is broken down to 888, that the number or the numeral or the geometria 888 equals Jesus Christ. Why is that number 888 important? Because oxygen is the eighth element on the periodical chart. 8 protons, 8 neutrons, 8 electrons. 888. So they're telling you that when we talk about Jesus is the Word made flesh, what are they talking about? They're talking about oxygen. And so when Jesus said, it's my Father who art in heaven, and that he represents his Father, talking about hydrogen. We are getting caught up in the stories thinking that it's the actual being that this story is talking about, when it actually is a manifestation, as you are a manifestation of these stories in human form right here and right now. So we're talking about in its elemental state, we're talking about oxygen and hydrogen. All right? I get to what I'm talking about a little bit further. So breatharians get nurtured from the purest source, which is hydrogen, the universal life force, which contains all bodily needs. It is not necessary to have a certain religion or belief to do the process, which is the breatharian. But this is what we found out. All right? Oh. Let me go on. So God is consciousness, all right? This is what we mean by the creator. God is the source of creation itself, all right? It is not independent of you. It is the totality of everything. So when I speak of God, I'm not talking about just the physical self. I'm talking about the expression of God's self that rests within each and every one of us. The verb energy, right? So once you think God is a noun, which is a person, place, or thing, you separate yourself from it and immediately become a limited being. But when you say energy, which is a verb, which is an action, then you have actually understood what God actually is. That's what separates the believers, which is religious, from the knowers, which is spiritual. And remember, spirit means breath. So you know God through the breath, because God breathed into the nostrils of man the breath of life and made man the living soul. So if you understand the science of breath, you would breathe properly in order to reconnect to your personal Lord and Savior, which is your divine soul. All right? Because God is energy, a vibrating relative to the frequency of source. The source being the very center of the universe of energy, and the physical world being the outermost shell. The physical three-dimensional universe as observed by means of the physical senses, existing at the lowest rate of the vibration and at the highest density. The physical universe of matter represents only a tiny fraction of the universe of energy and the vibration in its entirety. Because what they found out that God is also mind, and mind is totality. The first principle of, for those who read the Kabbalion, get the Kabbalion written by the three initiates. All right, in that book, the first principle of Tahuti, all right, or Jehuti, is mentalism. The all is mind, and everything in the universe is what? Mental. Everything is energy. All right? That's what we have to understand, overstand. All right, so the universe is created in the mind of God. The laws of the universe follows the law of mind. Everything is made of pure energy, which is consciousness. Consciousness creates everything and directs everything. By understanding the mind, we are able to understand reality. Mind is everything, and the mind controls everything. This is why the universe is mental. So man, as we said earlier, is a walking thought form. So you are a physical existence of the mind right here, right now, that I can perceive. Hence, you are a physical representation of God, as you are a concentration of God in human form. This is why the Bible says in 1 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter, the 16th verse, do you not know that your body is the temple of God? Do you not know that your body is the temple of God? What body are they talking about? This body. The only body that you have. And the only one God that resides in this one body. That's the reason why you only have one God that you should pray to. And you praying to anything outside of yourself, which is symbolic to another God, why that is blasphemy to the God within. And the reason why God in the Old Testament said, I'm a jealous God. Because here you are praying to all these idol gods outside of yourself, when you should be actually praying to the God within and getting to know about God within. This is what this is all talking about. So, all right, so we find out even in the word human, the word hu, which is Sanskrit, it says the word huma, which is for human, represents spirit. And the word ma, all right, symbolizes water. In the English, the word human explains the two facts, which are characteristics of humanity. Hu also means God, and man means mind. So when the word human, you know, comes together, it actually means the God mind. So human is not just a hue, as in the coloration of your skin, your pigmentation, and man symbolizes the symbolic to the ground itself. That's in one scenario, but when you go to the characteristics of the word hue, which means man, mean God, and then man means mind, then you got a more clearer understanding of what you represent. Your mind, you know what I'm saying, should be God-like. Think about it. God created you in his image and after his likeness, right? What is it that you use to create images and likenesses? Your mind. You get it? Right. So if God created you in his image and after his likeness, and the thing that you use to produce images and likenesses is your mind, then what is God telling you? Right. All right. So, this is why in Proverbs, the 23rd chapter, the 7th verse, it says, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. All right. Therefore, the first of the principles, which you said, is of Tahuti, is mentalism. The all is mind and everything in the universe is mental. All right. So, in order to defeat what we refer to as menticide, we must change our paradigm or perception or state of mind. We must stop acknowledging idol images. All right, such as said white Jesus, said white Muhammad, all of these things is detrimental to us because it's something other than who we are. And it's something external oftentimes that they have us worshiping. All right, Proverbs, the 3rd chapter, the 31st verse says, envy thou not the oppressor and choose none of his ways, because greater is he within you than he that is in the world. This is John, 1st John, the 4th chapter, the 44th verse. Hold up. What did it say? Greater is he within you than he that is in the world. Now, Oral Roberts used to say this every Sunday. And if you didn't really understand, then, you know, just my grandma had me put my hands on the TV. Because Oral Roberts said, put your hands on the TV. So my hands were right there on the TV, too. But that stayed in my mind. Greater is he within you than he that is in the world. So oftentimes we look for these idols in the world. But greater is he within you. All right? 1 Corinthians 3:16. Do you not know that you are the temple of God and the Spirit of God dwells in you? 1 Corinthians 16:19 through 20. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit which is in you? 2 Corinthians 13:5. Do you not know yourself that Jesus Christ is in you? Now hold up. That's all three. That's the Holy Trinity. God, the Holy Spirit, and Jesus. So here we are. We was taught in the exoteric form of Christianity that Jesus was somebody who's going to come back to save us, when the Bible clearly states in 2 Corinthians 3:13-5 that Jesus Christ is in you. This is what Jesus already said anyway. When you read the story, Jesus said in Luke, 21st chapter of Luke, he says, look neither here nor there, for behold, the kingdom of God is within you. But see, they had us thinking that just Jesus Christ. Now understand, Jesus Christ is different than just Jesus. Christ symbolizes consciousness. That Christ consciousness in which that returns to us once we understand who we are. That Christ consciousness is what we refer to as Melchizedek or Michael. He who dares to be like God, or that God principle once again we come back in contact with. Right, this is what this is all really talking about. So right here it says, therefore, God said Holy Trinity exists in you. Esoteric, not just exoteric, but you also exist in God. Because just like the ocean is in a fish, while at the same time the fish is in the ocean. Anybody get what we just said on that?
Break it down, Paul.
All right. So, what we find out is that the first substance in which that we talked about, which deals with hydrogen, which is produced through that fusion of dark matter and black energy, we find that the first substance of the universe is actually hydrogen, but that is actually what produces what's called magnetism. It is created by condensation. Condensation of what? What is condensing? It's condensing of the mind. It's the condensation of the mind. So God mind, in its expanded state, i.e. the universe, forms the first substance, which is magnetism. Magnetism condenses further and forms the second substance called electricity. Electricity condenses into light, all right, which is the third substance. Electricity, first thought to be a fluid, is now understood to be basically particles, which is called electrons, which further condense into the fourth state, which is called ether or space. All right, so the last three substances, which is gas, liquid, and solid, condenses. So that is actually what you are a product of. You're a product of magnetism, light. Well, magnetism, electricity, light, which deals with electrons. All right? Solid, liquid, and gas. Once again, seven bodies. Seven bodies. All right? Those four, solid, liquid, and gas, and then you have the four other states, is actually also chemicals. You have chemical ether, you have life ether, you have light ether, and you have mental ether. All right? That is the Rosicrucian interpretation, or the way in which that they state. But it's all the same thing. All right, so these are the seven substances of the universe, all coming out of nothing, or what is perceived to be nothingness, or the mind of God. When we say the mind of God is nothing, it doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. It means that the mind is not a thing. And it's obvious to everyone that the mind or consciousness is not tangible. It's not a tangible thing. Yet it is the source of all things. The Vedic wisdom tells us that the soul is our consciousness. And consciousness is the mind. All right? So the soul is our consciousness and consciousness is our mind. So we know that energy does not carry consciousness. Consciousness directs energy. So every neuron triggered, every action you take, every pulse, every wave, all light, all sound, all radiation, you've been looking for the spirit within them. But they're all within the spirit. All right? I'm going to let that marinate. So, as we was talking about, hydrogen is the first element in the particle chart and most basic and common of all elements in the universe. Over 90% of all atoms in the universe are hydrogen atoms. And they are the lightest of all elements. The name hydrogen comes from the Greek word hydro, which means water. Hence the word H2O. All right? Hydrogen, two-part oxygen. What is it? Hydrogen and two-part oxygen. Right? All right, so Lavoisier knew that hydrogen was in all water molecules. So what happened is that the sun equals hydrogen is because the sun gives off hydrogen and is very easy to burn. And as you know, the sun is one big ball of fire. One of the elements that makes the sun burn so brightly is hydrogen itself. So in order to make you burn, what you think you have to take in? Hydrogen. All right? So that means that the burning force behind oxygen is hydrogen. That's the force behind oxygen. And I'm going to keep getting to that because hydrogen is the most abundant element in the universe. It can replace most types of fuel, even for the human body. It burns clean, and when hydrogen is burnt by oxygen, water forms and energy is released. Uh-oh. Let me say that again. When hydrogen is burned by oxygen, water forms and energy is released. That's the science of H2O. And the reason why you are 75% what? Water. Hydrogen is the fundamental antioxidant. As the smallest element, it reaches every organ in every cell. Hydrogen is the source of fuel. Hydrogen-rich water neutralizes toxins and washes them away. Hydrogen cleanses the electric or energetic body too. All right, this is what it said. Albert Jarry, the Nobel Prize-winning biochemist, said that hydrogen, rather than oxygen, was the fuel of life. Everybody knows we need oxygen to live, but oxygen's counterpart, hydrogen, is the real fuel. Oxygen burns hydrogen and releases the energy in the form of ATP, which runs our bodies. Water supplies both the fuel, hydrogen, and the fire, oxygen. All right? It is hydrogen that is often the limiting factor. It says the word hydrogen also means water form. All right? Look at the word hydro. Hydro means water, but then gen means fire. So actually, hydrogen actually means water and fire. So this is when the burning of hydrogen comes into effect with oxygen, because gen is also an end of oxygen. You see? Oxy means air. Air and fire. So hydrogen, first element is what? Water and fire. In interplay with what is called oxygen is air and fire. Two-part fire, really. One part air, one part water. All right? What's the four elements in which they told you that brings about life? Earth. Wind, which is air, water, and fire. The only one that is missing, right, is earth. The only one missing is earth. Guess where that comes in at? That comes in carbon, which is the sixth element on the periodical chart. Guess what your body is? You're a carbon being.
Does that only apply to brown people?
Well, there's carbon units. All right, the European Albion would be a carbon unit, but you are a carbon being because your essence is essentially that of carbon because you are melanated. But in order to live, they also have to be carbon, so they are a carbon unit. So that comes into play as far as life itself. All right, so what we have is that hydrogen means water forming, which is actually creation of water or a plasmic river of hydrogen and helium, as well as electromagnetic radiation, in which that's what we refer to as cosmic rays or, you know, celestial dust. This is part of what is used to let there be light, as we would say, you know, which that forms the spectrum of lights in the third dimension. Of course, you have Roy G. Biv, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. That's Roy G. Biv, or the seven colors of the visible spectrum. All right? We know that's in between radio waves, microwaves, infrared waves, and then you have visible spectrum. Then you have what is known as ultraviolet light, X-rays, and gamma rays, all right? We know that melanin, speaking of melanin, melanin is the effective absorber of light. The pigment is able to dissipate over 99.9% of the absorbed UV radiation. That's why melanin is so important, especially on this planet where the sun produces UV radiation, all right? Albinism was not a natural product. That was came through by unnatural means, all right? That came through, as they would say, scientists would say, well, that came through change in climate, that came through following into peace out. All right, it came through different climates, it came through us going into cold, areas, into cold areas, and so forth and so on. I won't get into all of that right now, but I'm sorry. Well, we do know that we need a variety of fruits and vegetables, colors, all right? We know our chakras is based on that. For example, the root chakra, beets, parsnips, apples, pomegranates, protein. For the solar plexus, not solar plexus, but the navel chakra, seeds, nuts, oranges, pumpkins, even carrots, even though it's said to be a hybrid. Solar plexus, yellow peppers, yellow lentils, yellow squash, oats, bananas. Green, which is for the heart chakra, would be broccoli, kale, which is both of those are hybrids too, but chard, and all leafy green vegetables. Then you have the blue chakra, which is blueberries, blue raspberries, figs, kelp, which is active blue-green algae, would be good there. And then you also have for the third eye, blackberries, plums, purple grapes, etc. Then for the crown chakra, fruits, fresh air, sunlight, and nature itself. All right, so these fruits and vegetables feed those particular chakras, all right? So you need, on an everyday basis, you need a fruit salad or a green leafy vegetable type of salad in which that helps, you know, with different colors in it, you know, like we spoke about, in which that can give this endocrine glands or these chakras the proper nutrition, all right? What happened is that by going into cold climates, you did not have access to what? The proper sunlight, You didn't have access to fruits and vegetables as you once did in warm climates. Like, for example, we can take a trip right now to Florida. I can take you down the street in Florida right now. We can pull off ugly fruit. We can pull off graviola, which is sour sap. We can pull off moringa leaves, eat them joints right there from the trees. You know what I'm saying? Oranges, everything is right there. So when you move from out of climates in which that can produce food for you and healthy for you, just like we came from out of the interior of Africa, where there was plentiful of life, right? And we ended up going to all these various areas and climates. And so hence came about what we refer to as, in some cases, what first came is vitiligo. You know what causes vitiligo? Loss of vitamin B12. That's what causes vitiligo. Okay? You know what vitiligo is? No, vertigo is when you get dizzy. Vitiligo is, right, is the skin discoloration. Right, when you start turning pale, right. Well, that's what happened first. So when it's severely vitamin B12, vitamin B6 deficiency, because guess what? Those two elements is what cleanses your melanin. Those two vitamins cleanses your melanin. B6 and B12 in particular. So, right, maintains your pigmentation. So when you're out of an environment which is no longer nurturing you with the vitamin B12 and B6, you become what? You start going through vitiligo. Eventually, you become pale, which is albino, albinism. And then if you was kept away from civilization for an extended period of time, and basically what you was doing is simply practicing incest for over a period of time, you would come up with the albion race in which that you see now, who can't reproduce itself, who can't make any of us, but can only reproduce once again within themselves. So two albions can only make another albion. They can't make someone, for example, you can take even two individuals who have vitiligo or who has the first stages of albinism, and they can still produce generations, people who look just as dark as us in here. But even within their generation, it's four generations, all right? For example, let's say albino man and albino woman came together. Both of them are albinos, but guess what? They will have four generations, and only one out of the four will be what? Albino. The other three will look just like us. Two will have the traits, right? Who ever heard of Punnett square, right? Bingo. So here we have the European scientist by the name of Gregory Mendel, the so-called father of European father of genetics. He had Big B, which is what? Gene dominant. Big B, little B traits had dominant, but yet had recessive trait. Little B, big B, means recessive but dominant trait. And then little B, all recessive. The Albion is all recessive. You are big B. And those in between, as far as quote unquote races are concerned, because there's four major races, right? Name them for me. Right, so-called black and brown people, right? That's us, red and yellow, and then white, right? So black and brown would be big B, right? I'm just trying to give it to you, right? Red would be big B, little B. Yellow would be little B, big B. White folks would be what? Pale folks would be what? Little B, Albion. That's the Punnett square. That's just what it is. You know what I'm saying? So I'm just showing you, you know, I ain't want to get there, but we'll be talking about melanin. And melanin is the most ancient and widespread pigment in living organisms. The very thing that color That colors the bark of a tree that's brown or black in the soil of the ground, which is the most richest soil. This brother here going to talk about it in a few minutes. The richest soil is what color, bro? It's black. All right? So it dwells in your very essence, which is your genetics. Because remember, they told you that you came from the ground. That's what the Bible tells you, right? Right? Man was made from the dust of the ground. That's what the Bible says. And from the midst of the waters, which is called clay, essentially. The Quran says that man was made from black mud. Adam was made from black mud. What is that black? Black mud. And the name in Arabic is called Hanama. Hanama. Black. But guess what it means? That's your melanin. That's the black mud. Right? This is why God or Allah told Iblis, the devil, Satan, that I know that which that you do not know. Because Iblis was like, look, I was made from fire. I was made before him. Why are you taking an interest in this dude? He made from the ground. He made from mud. But mud, black mud is nothing but carbon, y'all. What color is carbon? Black. And it's the sixth element on the periodical chart. It's the sixth element on the periodical chart. How many? Six protons, six neutrons, six what? Electrons. 666. Mm-hmm. The mark of the beast. That's in the book of Revelation. It says, here's wisdom. Here's wisdom for a man who had that wisdom. Here's the wisdom. Six scores and six and six. Revelation, the 13th chapter. Look it up. So it's talking about when you identify with your physical body, material body, more so than you do the spiritual, you receive the mark of the beast. In other words, you receive everything that is just physical because you believe that I'm only you, born to make mistakes. Because that's what you believe. Right? That's the belief. Is that, and I'm not right. What's up, brother? Is that, if I'm not right?
Yes.
That's it, right?
No, you hit that note on point, though,
God. Oh. I mean, but that's how he do it, right? That's the sound, right? That's how he do it. Right. Cause he's trying to make you look. If that's what you identifying with, then so be it. I'm sorry. I know that there's more to me than just the mud. But I am in the mud, you know what I'm saying? But I'm not of the mud. Alright? That's what Jesus meant. Well, I'm in the world, but I'm not of the world. Because I'm of my Father. Alright? And the Father just simply is the soul in the pineal gland. That's the Father. Alright? Not the Father out here somewhere. Alright? We ain't talking about, because Muslims believe that Allah is far, far, far away. Somewhere out. But yet, the Quran says that Allah is closer to you than your jugular vein. So how do you think that God or Allah is somewhere so far, far away? How you get that? When it says God is closer to you than your jugular vein. Ask a Sufi where God dwells at. It said God dwells within the heart of man. Even in the Holy Quran, Circle 7. Or the 101s, the 102s. It says, what's the closest, what's the quickest way you can reach Allah? It's in the heart. The closest place you can reach Allah is in the heart. That is a Sufi tradition. That's the Sufi saying. That is a Christian tradition too. All of the esoteric traditions all say the same thing. So if you're a Christian, then you go with Gnosticism. If you are a Jew or Jewish traditions, Hebrew, Israelites, then you go with the Kabbalah, Kabbalistic teachings. If you are a Muslim, then you go with the Sufi traditions. All right. If you are a Buddhist, then you go with the Zen traditions. All of the esoteric schools say the same thing. They're all the same. We're the ones who are fussing at each other over our differences because we're looking at it from an esoteric point of view, an external point of view. Oh, my God, better than yours.
bet my Jesus is going to come back before yours do. Be looking at it from an egotistical point of view. And this has nothing to do with ego. Ego is what got us in this predicament. That's what got us here. You wanted to explore your ego. That's how we got here. And we go through our life trying to tame ego. That's what this is about. You know what I'm saying? That's why you were given these rules and regulations. To tame ego. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. In other words, thou shalt not lie. Thou shalt not. That's why you was given the Ten Commandments, which we know come from the 42 codes of Mayat, or the 147 codes of the Mayatian laws. All right? Some say 77 Mayatian laws. However, 42, 77, 147 is the Mayatian codes. So Mayat, which means justice, mercy, love, right, which happened to be the same as we say within, quote unquote, love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice, brother. Right. All right. Well, those are the same principles that we find within the Mayatian code. She represents justice, right, truth, reciprocity, balance, order, harmony, and truth. Did I say truth twice?
Once.
Once? Okay, just making sure. All right, so all of this is correlating to the same thing. So melanin gives you the ability to absorb all the frequencies of the universe. All right, that's gamma rays, X-rays, ultraviolet light, visible light spectrum, infrared rays, microwaves, and radio waves. All right, so this is the thing. What is the primary function of DNA, which melanin itself has its own DNA? It's electromagnetic reception and transmission. Less than 10% of your DNA functions includes protein manufacturing. More than 90% of the functions involve the realm of bioacoustics and bioelectrical signaling. What do that mean? That means that your melanin has the ability to absorb not just sunlight, X-rays, but also music, sound waves. So you see why they changed the frequency of the music. The music, natural music, is at 4,432 hertz. The frequency that they have music at now is at 440 hertz.
That's way sped up.
Right. 432 hertz was the natural music, natural frequency. 440 hertz is what they have now for you. So, and then they dumb it down even further and give you trap music, which is the bastardized of rap music, which was already a bastard child of hip-hop. It's called mumbling rap. Just sound like you got stuff in your mouth. Who heard it?
I heard Designer.
Oh, you heard it?
Oh, yeah.
How it goes,
bro? Timmy. I don't know nothing they saying, bro. Nothing they saying. I don't understand. No word. How could you even make a song about Timmy Turner anyway? Timmy Turner's a cartoon character. So it's all dumbing people down, man, you know. That's just what it is, you know?
It was. Hip-hop was at one time third degree. Mm. I mean, third grade level. This thing done went to preschool. Oh, yeah, worse.
Yeah, this is worse.
Yeah. I don't even know what you call it now. All right, but see, this is what Dr. Lynn Horowitz said. So get Dr. Lynn Horowitz information. She's the one who come out now with the 528 hertz, in which that tells you about that. So listen to 528 hertz. Melanin has its own DNA, as we stated, and is the most important substance in the human body. Carbon atom links to form melanin, which has black hole properties. So what happens with a black hole? Black hole is able to absorb light, right? All right, keep that in mind. Which are found in space. In physics, a so-called black body is known to be a perfect absorber and perfect radiator of all forms of light and energy. The black body radiation is at work in the electron, as shown by Nobel Peace Prize winner Richard Feynman. All right? Check this out. The electron is responsible for all chemical changes in matter. Once again, check that out now. The electron is responsible for all chemical changes in matter. Melanin may be viewed as a battery that is partially charged and can always accept an electrical charge. When sunlight or other energy comes in contact with the melanin battery, it increases the charge of the battery to a certain degree. In humans, melanin is the primary determinant of skin color. It is also found in hair, pigment of skin, underlying the iris of the eyes, the inner ears, all over the body. In the brain tissues, and with melanin includes the pineal gland, which is the master gland of the physical body, the medulla oblongata, and all over in the brain, the various 12 pairs of brain stems or nerves, and also the 12 melanin sites in the brain stem, I should say. So we find out that melanin is essential for the absorption of this energy. Once again, music, light, heat, everything. So what happens is that when we transform carbon 12, which is carbon 666, into carbon 7, which is carbon 616, it goes to 6 electrons, 1 neuron, and 6 protons. So you change your carbon from 666 to 616. That's why 666 is the mark of the beast. Because your job is to change from carbon 12 to carbon 7. Now, what is carbon 7? Carbon 7 is the material equivalent of the Kundalini system, which is known as the Metatron cube. Like iron has the ability to sustain a magnetic field around it, carbon 7 has the uncanny ability to change the hyperdimensional fields, such as fields of thought around it. Thus, it can amplify thoughts, and can hyperdimensional fields can also be produced, just as iron and copper in a transformer can amplify magnetic fields. Naturally, it has out-of-body experiences. Naturally, it is formed in the brains of spiritual adepts. All right, everybody seen the 1600s pictures of Jesus and of the prophets. Every time you see them pictures, you always see them with a halo around their head. Is that halo possible for you to obtain? Yes. Because you have to transform carbon 666 to carbon 616. Let's continue on. So, naturally, it is formed in the brain of spiritual adepts when they have an out-of-body experience or perform other supernatural phenomena such as biolocation and materialization, etc. During such times, the glow or halo that is formed around the heads of these highly evolved beings is actually due to the excess neutrons produced within carbon 12, which is transmuted to carbon 7, inside their brain. Uh-oh. This is your pineal gland, which begins to start producing DMT. What is DMT? We'll get to that in a second. During the human birth experience, the brain is being excreted, and is saturated with DMT, which is dimethyltryptophan, and also phenylalanine. That's what DMT is. These chemicals are secreted by the pineal gland, also known as the seed of the soul. The seed of the soul. So when these chemicals reactions happen, the brain literally is being awakened as one begins the human experience. You're not even living as a human being until you transform to carbon 7. It don't even happen until you transform to carbon 7. We're just existing. But we're not living until we transform to carbon. All right? And I'll show you an example of this. This is an example of a spiritual adept with the halo coming from the head.
which comes by way of meditation. Think about it. Be still and know God. What do you think be still and know God means? Which is in your Bible. Be still and know God. It means to meditate, exactly. This is what he's doing. He's sitting still and he's knowing God. The Lord, a personal Savior. His divine soul is being activated, which is radiating. So now he becomes the son of the sun. Because now he shines like the sun. Christians say, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Oh, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Who heard that before? Huh? Yeah, everybody has. So this little light is supposed to be shining. That means the energy inside of you is supposed to be reacting to the point that we are emitting this type of vibration. This type of energy. This is how he's getting to know his Lord and personal Savior. Because by developing what is known as his golden body, he survived death. He survived death. Brother Elo, he can talk about some of this here. He'd be dropping on his radio show on the golden body. But this is what we're supposed to be becoming. And this is produced by dimethyltryptamine and pinoline, which is called DMT, which is supposed to be produced in our brains. We have it. Most of the time, it's just given to us during birth and death. The first part of it is released at birth, and then the last bit of it is released at death. But in between, you can utilize it if you just sit and meditate and relieve yourself of all the burdens, that yoke. Leave yourself with that cross that you have to bear. The cross is the physical body itself. This is the cross. This is the cross that Jesus had to bear. Jesus symbolized the forces which hold the physical body together. Centripetal and centrifugal force is the force that holds your physical composition together. Without it, you decompose. You know that, right? What is centripetal and centrifugal force? You call it insulation and exhalation. That is the force that holds your physical body together. When that force is no longer there, this body, back to the ground. So centripetal and centrifugal force, which is push and pull, insulation and exhalation is what holds your physical composition together. That is the word made flesh. You get it? The word made flesh. We continue. Yeah. All right. Let's look at it. Christians tell you that the word made flesh was Jesus. Right? Because Jesus was with God and Jesus was God. Well, if you go back to the Old Testament, it says God breathed into the nostrils the breath of life and made man a living soul. So Christians say that Jesus was with God in the beginning. Well, what if Jesus wasn't a man who just came 2,000 years ago, but was a force in which that was put within us years ago? Hence the reason why when we read 2 Corinthians 13, it says, do you not know that Jesus Christ is within you? That is the Christ, or the Jesus Christ that actually was put within us. We're looking for a man, a European man at that, who is the son of Caesar Boyer, and who was created during the Nicene Council of 325 AD to come back and save us. We know that man does not exist. Okay? That was a metaphor. For you to understand that you can always come into being. As long as you have breath in your lungs, you can always reconnect and recontact the God within. But you have to go within to do that. That's what is known as the return of Jesus. Because you always have the ability to return. You yourself tore yourself from God because of the doctrine that you was taught. So you debased yourself and thought that you was only human.
It just reminded me of that scripture real fast. Every eye should see Jesus in the clouds.
Right.
Well, how do we go see through the clouds?
The clouds is the brain.
Exactly.
Because you have gray matter and white matter.
Yeah.
What color is the clouds? White. And when it get dark and it start to rain, what color are they? Gray. So the white and gray matter in your brain is symbolic to the clouds. Guess what? Remember, it also says in the book of Revelation that Jesus was going to come back on a what? A cloud, but he was also come out the cloud, but he was going to be on a white horse. Well, hold up. Only story I read about the white horse was Pegasus, which was in the Greek mythology. A flying white horse. His name was Pegasus, right? Okay, well, guess what? In your brain, there's an area called the white horse, too. It's called the hippocampus area. The word hypo... Campius means white horse. Guess what happens when that area is activated in your brain? It gives you psychic abilities. Is this over? You see what's going on? They took something that was talking about your physical anatomy and your spirituality, dealing with your connection here on Earth, and they made it as if it was just an entity outside of you and put it back in the past so that you can always be forever looking for something to come and save you. And in particular, a European, who we know is a painting of Cesar Bonnier, who was drawn by Leonardo da Vinci. Leonardo da Vinci won that contest between him and Michelangelo. Michelangelo got a chance to do the Sistine Chapel. Well, you see, God and Adam, you don't touch your fingers like this. You know, so Michelangelo got a chance to do that. But the Jesus picture that we have within our homes, which the European, came from Cesar Bonnier. That was his, that was him. And of course, we finagged it just a little bit. But that was his picture. That's where that concept comes from. Cesar Bonnier. And who was Cesar Bonnier? He was the bastardized child of Pope Alexander VI. Now, you know, ain't no Pope supposed to have no children. That's why he's the bastard.
In fact, he had a lot of
them,
that Pope.
Yeah, oh, yeah, that Pope was getting it in.
He was denying all of them, like,
yeah, exactly. Damn, right. They got there talking about brothers.
Right,
oh,
right.
No, I can go right in history.
But they gave it to us, though.
Right. I can go right in history and show where this dude here was popping them out and he wasn't claiming none of them.
Yeah.
Cause Pope, because this Pope wasn't supposed to be, but he was a Bonnier. Go back and watch the TV shows Bonnier.
Yep, Borgias. Yeah.
Right, the Borgias. Right, Borgias. Go back and watch the Bonnier. Go back and watch that TV show. It shows you in there. It was a TV show that came out like about what, 5 years ago, something like that, somewhere around 5 years ago.
And it starts at 1492.
Uh oh. Mm-hmm. I ain't gonna get in that one. Right. When the Moors were forced out of Spain. Right. The last stronghold was Granada. All right. And along with them was the Hebrews, who was forced out. Okay. We'll get to that probably, you know, soon. Yeah.
Excuse me.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Yeah. All right. So the question now, how was matter formed? Well, matter was formed by sound. Thought travels 24 billion miles per second. When it slowed down to around 186,000 miles per second, it transformed to light. When light is slowed down to 1,120 feet per second, it transformed to sound. Light and sound is the same thing, just faster frequency or speed. It's the same thing. So you find out that sound is what formed geometrical shapes. Sound for geometrical shapes. You don't believe me? Take a steel pan and put salt or either sand particles on it and play a speaker next to it. And play a sound for it, and it will actually form geometrical shapes on that steel pan. Yeah, it's called cymatics. Right. So matter itself is essentially cymatics in the structure of space itself. All right, so cymatics, that's what cymatics is. So sound forms and makes shapes. That's what the word made flesh. The word made flesh, that's talking about in the book of John, is talking about your body being made. That flesh being made is from the word, which is sound itself. The sound, according to the Vedic text, is the Om sound. Om. That sound vibrated throughout the universe and formed what we now call the string theory, now formed what we refer to as the unified field theory. I get a good book. It's by Gabriel Oyibo, his book, which was in colleges, but it wasn't. It was in Ivy League schools. You could have went to Harvard and Yale and got his book, but you wasn't going to find that HBCU, or historical black college university. You wasn't going to find it at one of them, but you can find his book at Harvard and Yale, in which he breaks down the unified field theorem that Albert Einstein was looking for. Albert Einstein was never able to find it. He just came up with the theory of relativity. E equals mc squared. E, which is energy, equals mass or matter per constant what? The speed of light. So light, we know, is what forms matter, but it's slowed down light, which is sound. And sound travels at 1,120 feet per second. And at that point, it forms the geometrical shapes. In particular, man is a six-pointed star configuration. Woman is a five-pointed star configuration. In the sexual act, 5 and 6 becomes the number 11. How many letters is in abracadabra? It's 11. Because that is talking about the manifestation of God. It's talking about it's come forth through birth. You're thinking that it's just magic. And it is somewhat because you can't see the process in which that is taking place in the womb for those 9 months. Only thing you know, the out product is a child here. You can't see where that head of the sperm breaks off and meet equivalently with the nucleus of the egg, and it blown up to equivalent size. And it's blown to the equivalent size of the egg, and then it goes through cellular division, become a blastopore, become an amoeba, becomes a zygote, becomes a fetus, and 9 months later it becomes your child. Oh, he's so cute. You don't know. So that is magic to you. That's the most fantastic magic. That's why magic, the highest magic is actually through Tantra. Tantra Kriya Yoga, or Tantra Yoga. So, right here, we find it says, no point is more central than this, that empty space is not empty. It is the seat of the most violent physics. This is scientist, John Wilder. And he goes on that basically only about 1% of all we know is matter. Only about 1%. Right? Remember, we said 99.9999% of the atomic structure is apparently empty space. That means 0.0001% appears to be solid. That's what that means. All right, so let me go on here. This is the thing. This is what scientists found out. This is from a German book called Venesith Intellectuals. It's by Gresna Fosser and Franz Brudolf. The latest research explains phenomena such as clairvoyance, intuition, spontaneous and remote acts of healing, self-healing, affirmation techniques, unusual light, auras around people, which is called orbs, namely spiritual masters, mind influences or ancestors, mind influences on weather patterns, and much more. This is what it says. The Russian scientists also found out that our DNA can work, can cause disturbing patterns in vacuum, thus producing magnetized wormholes. Your DNA, check this out now, your DNA can cause disruptive patterns in vacuums, thus producing magnetized wormholes. What are wormholes? Wormholes are the microscopic equivalent to what is known as the Rosen bridges in the vicinity of black holes, which is left by burnt out stars. So your DNA magnetized wormhole is actually symbolic to the black hole, which I talked about. Your melanin has black hole's properties. It's actually left by burnt out stars. Remember what I told you that what brought you here? What had to die?
Star.
Exactly. Is that a coincidence that scientists have found this out? So 300,000 tons of stardust energy fall to the planet Earth daily. 300,000 tons of stardust energy fall to the planet Earth daily. So if you, your body was produced by, left by burnt out stars, and you, your DNA, which is collection of memories of your ancestors, and you are that in human form right here and right now, that means, that, and it's a bridge, what do you have the capability of doing?
Crossing the bridge,
because that's what you do on the bridge, don't you? Are you going to be like a chicken who wait to cross the road? You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? What they say about the chicken? Why the chicken cross the road, right? It was to get to the other side. So the same thing with you. You got bridges in your DNA, and you're just going to stay on this side of the bridge when there's 300,000 tons of stardust energy that falls that you can absorb in order to give you the ability in order to cross the bridge, in order to get to the other side. Chickens. You get it? Because who's on the other side? Your ancestors that passed on, that formed your, that helped you form the physical body that you have in physical existence. It's your bridge in order to communicate with them. Oh, hold on. See, y'all, I don't know if y'all got what I just said. These are tunnels, connections between entirely different areas in the universe through which information can be transmitted outside of space and time. Who's seen the movie Doctor Strange?
It was good.
Yes, yeah. It's out. And if you ain't seen it, good God Almighty.
Go.
You need to go see it, because everything I'm talking about is in this movie.
Sure is. They did a movie for us. Doctor Strange. Marvel Comics.
Doctor Strange. I'm going to see that again.
You got to.
I'm sorry. Oh, there's an IMAX 3D
yes.
joint? Oh, I'm going to go
God.
See that. I ain't seen the 3D joint.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
See, you just put me up on something. I'm going to see that. All right. So I don't want to spoil the movie, but put it this way. The Matrix, Adjustment Bureau, and this movie all have doors in which that you can go through in which that give you the bridge in order to cross into other dimensions or other timelines. I'm going to leave it right there.
Like Inception.
Bing. Inception, right. All four of those movies. Inception, Adjustment Bureau, Matrix, and Doctor Strange. All four of those movies show you that there's a door, or in particular a bridge, a tunnel of some sort that can cross you over into another timeline. All right? So it says the DNA attracts these bits of information and passes them on to our consciousness. So the DNA, which is a magnetized wormhole, attracts these bits of information. So that means you can actually receive information from what is called the Akashic Records, which is the Universal Library. This is also shown on a movie last night, which my wife and I seen, which is Doctor Strange. So what we are seeing here is hypercommunication, where information is passed interdimensionally. And it is as though DNA acts as a stargate between this dimension and others. DNA is but a giant molecule, and the molecule are many atoms joined together. That's what they told us. So really, this is to say that our brain is actually a collection of universes. Wormholes. Did y'all get that? So you actually are, in miniature form, the universe. And in particular, your brain via your mind. So your mind actually is the drawing or the attractive force. This is why they showed you the movie Secrets. Who's seen the movie Secrets? Somebody explain to me what the movie was talking about. Right quick.
The law of attraction.
The law of attraction. And what did they tell you that you use in order to attract?
The mind.
Your consciousness. Exactly. But they didn't tell you that inside your brain, there's wormholes via your DNA in which that you can magnetize and draw the things to you. And they didn't teach you the breath technique, in which is the link between and the unification between your mind, body, and spirit soul. They didn't tell you that the breath is the connection between that, because you don't remember. Your breath is your spirit. So it is the mind, and the body, and the soul. The connecting piece between that is the breath or the spirit itself. That is connection. So, this is what we find out. At the end of a previous universe, our ancestors was able to expand their mind beyond measure until they encompassed their whole universe. That process of expansion caused an apparent contraction of their universe until it was reduced to the size of a single planet. Guess what happened? Guess the reason why you being put in a state of fear. It's because your mind was actually at one time encompassing this universe. Guess what? Scientists say that this universe is now what? Contracted. Remember, at one time they were saying that it was expanding, but now it's contracting. So what do they have to do to those who are in the most perfect image of God? Bingo, put us to sleep.
Have us scared as I don't know what.
Right, and have us frightened, exactly. So that our minds would not encompass the whole universe, because that's the purpose of mind control. Menticize. What is mind control? They have to be able to control your mind and keep it on a mundane level. Oh, who's going to be the next president? Hillary or Trump? They have to keep you on a mundane level. Because your mind is able to engulf the whole universe. And then you actually would jump to another one. I'm going to explain to you. Check this out. The process of expansion causes the apparent contraction of this universe, bless you, until it is reduced to the size of a single planet. This is where you get the Big Bang from, about the single atom. The universe was not reduced in reality, but when the mind is expanded, it appears as if the universe is contracting. That's what was going on. It appeared to them that it was contracting. It was not, but it was. And they knew that it appeared to be contracting. So they knew that they had to control our minds in order to keep that from happening, because they knew that if we ever was able to reduce the planet, all these planets to just a single planet. And I told you earlier how many planets there were in this galaxy and in this universe. Remember, 24 squared 20 Earth-like planets in this universe. That's just in this universe. That's 24 circles. That's 24 plus 20 circles behind it. When I say squared 20. All right. So the apparent contraction of this universe was not followed by a Big Bang or any other kind of explosion per se. It was followed by a condensation process, where parts of the expanded mind condense in stages to form empty space surrounding the new Earth, creating the seven substances: magnetism, electricity, light, heat, solid, liquid, and gas. Which eventually formed the new stars after many trillions of years. Now, since space itself is a substance and prana fills that space, it means that the mind creates space at the same time it occupies the very space. All right? Stars are the condensation of the minds of the ancestors who came from the previous universe. I'm going to say that again. Stars are the condensation of the mind of our ancestors who came from the previous universe. And you are them in this physical incarnation. That's the reason why 90% of your physical body is stardust particles. And a star had to die to bring you life. This increased, that means that they increased their own mind by expansion, which simultaneously caused the creation to exist to increase as well. This is how God or Goddess increased itself in creation to make itself eternity. The universe is eternal and infinite, creating and recycling back into itself, similar to how the image of the metals, the magnetosphere works. The universe is a circle that has no beginning or end, constantly emitting material and life and constantly recycling it. All right? This is the grand scale of what we call reincarnation, when universes do. And your mind is the universe, or your mind is the universe, and you are the universe in miniature form. All right? In particular, your mind itself. All right? So we're going to give a break. Have a little break for about how many minutes? About 15 minutes, and you'll come back and finish up.
All right. Let's give God a round of applause. While we're getting ready to break, I just want to say I appreciate everybody for coming out and showing their love and support. This is just the beginning. We're just getting started here. I definitely want to thank the God for coming out, him and the Goddess. They've been a very integral piece of my life right now. I'm very thankful my parents are here today. My uncle was here in the building today. She flew in the building. My co-worker, Mrs. Rachel, which is like my mom. You know, when nobody else is, my mom is here with me every day. So, again, I just want to say I thank everybody for coming out. We have some fruit and vegetables in the back, if you like. We'll get right back with you in about 15 minutes.
Need some fruits and vegetables.
Oh yeah, they're gonna the kids gonna come in a few. They wanna dance and they wanna sing, so we're gonna give them a little time. But I wanna let God finish his presentation first. And then I got a brother that's brother Jason gonna come up. We're gonna talk about some growing organic foods. And this brother's heavy with food. This is what he do every day. I've been in the field with him. And I know for sure this brother is dedicated to growing organic food and making sure that the community is healthy again.
Mm-hmm.
So
him and his mate.
Him and his wife as well, pardon me, Sister Joy Goddess. I want to thank Sister Celeste for coming in too. She's definitely been an integral piece in our life too as well, and helping us to get to this point. So again I just thank everybody for being here. And we'll get right back with you in about 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Hey God, listen. My mom and dad just wanted to meet you, brother.
Okay.
So,
okay.
You know, Pop's brother. So.
Melanin centers on that area.
Oh, yeah.
And there's 12
pineal
nerves.
It's
around the pineal gland
right.
Itself.
Well,
so 12 pairs, paired in 12 times 2, that's 24. So when you talk about the 24 elders around the throne of God, that's what he is.
Which I'm going to talk about that too.
Yeah.
So, that's how you are.
Hey. How are you?
You good?
His name is Jason. Okay.
Okay, that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. Yeah.
Oh, I need a pause. Okay, y'all, this is everybody building and eating. So this is what we had to eat. And we also did some grapes. So that's what we're working with.